Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I am Dave, and this week it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, RKO 1939. It'll be a Garson Kanin double feature for you this week. We'll be talking about Bachelor Mother and The Great Man Votes.
From a blossoming career of Ginger Rogers as a solo star and a big hit for the studio to the declining career of John Barrymore and a flop for the studio, but we enjoy them both.
Oh, these are two of my all-time favorite 30s movies. I'm very excited to talk about them. But for Garson Kanin, yes, very different economic fortunes for these pieces that he directed. Before we get into all of that, though, let us look at the Hollywood story and its list of RKO's roster of stars in 1939. This was compiled, as always, by Jewell W. Findler, and he's got his 1, 2, or 3 star ranking. This is based on his idiosyncratic impression of how much marquee value each of these people had to their respective studios during the length of their tenure at the studio. Notable departures prior to 1939, two very prominent faces of RKO during the 30s, Katharine Hepburn and Fred Astaire, both gone. Fred Astaire does appear in the story of Vernon and Irene Castle, the final Fred and Ginger film at RKO. That came out in 1939, but his contract was gone, apparently. So we start out with Ginger Rogers, 3 stars, obviously. Anne Shirley, 1 star. Of course, I don't agree with that, but perhaps the box office did show that.
They just kept using her, though, so it seems like they enjoyed having her around as a B-picture star.
Wonderful. Lucille Ball, 2 stars. Although she really hasn't begun headlining yet. She's on the verge. Cary Grant, 3 stars. Tim Holt, 1 star. Of course, Tim Holt was mostly a B-Western actor, although very notable appearances. I talk about this every time I guess he comes up, but he's in The Magnificent Ambersons. He's in The Treasure of the Sierra Madre. So big things ahead for this B-Western guy. Lupe Velez, 1 star. Maureen O'Hara, 2 stars. That's it. That's the complete list.
Refresh my memory, Dave. What's happening with RKO in the 40s? They're going to have a batch of new stars?
Oh yeah, it's going to be all different because the 40s, you're going to get the Val Lewton unit getting started.
Oh, that's right.
So horror, but amazing, non-Universal style horror. Not that we don't like Universal of the 30s, but what Universal in the 40s was doing was a lot of rubber masks.
But yeah, the Val Lewton unit, it's basically a B unit, isn't it? It doesn't really produce stars.
No, that's right. It will become known as the House of Noir, as Eddie Muller said. And so you're going to get a lot of amazing film noir from RKO. Those two, mostly B pictures, although some of them are going to break through and become huge successes like Crossfire.
Are they just going to become a B movie studio then? Or what are they doing for A material?
Yeah, they're a very small studio. They always have been, right? And you could see the roster of stars. It's not as small as Universal's, but it's not huge. The 40s, it's not going to get any bigger. They're very much aiming at sophisticated urban audiences. They don't have the kind of national coverage that a studio like MGM has, or Paramount, or Fox, or Warner Brothers.
Comparing it to the 30s, where they did actually have some stars that are not forgotten, although Katharine Hepburn even her stardom does begin with her successful films at RKO. She certainly did get critical and audience attention for those. And then, of course, Astaire and Rogers.
Right, so those were huge, right? Now, Ginger Rogers is going to stick with the studio for several more years, and she's going to continue continue to be a major marquee star. Cary Grant, too, will be there for a fair bit, and so he's going to be headlining a bunch of films, although he has a non-exclusive agreement, so he can do other things, and you see him at other studios throughout this time.
By the time of the major and the minor, is she at Paramount, or is that alone?
Yeah, that's alone, I believe.
All right, well, that's where we're heading next.
It's going to become even artier in the 40s. You know, we've got one episode, which is Citizen Kane and The Devil and Daniel Webster, two of the weirdest movies made in 1941 by major studios.
Is Berman gone?
He's gone. Yeah, he leaves in 1939. They get new management, George Schaefer. George Schaefer is the one that brings Orson Welles in and then has all kinds of problems
Has regrets about that.
Right. But a bold move, right? So RKO is the studio. I just mentioned Citizen Kane, but I kind of buried the lead. They're going to bring in Orson Welles and his Mercury Theater players, right? So that's the direction they're headed. Still more sophistication. So shall we start with Bachelor Mother?
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to read the substantial paragraph here from the RKO story. That's written by Richard Jewell and Vernon Harbin. This, I find, is one of the better ones, generally. Let's see if they got the plot right and how much we agree with their assessment of the film. RKO's most extraordinary sleeper of the decade was Bachelor Mother, a remake of Kleine Mutti, a 1935 Universal production filmed in Hungary. This moderately budgeted comedy realized profits of $827,000. Its star, Ginger Rogers, had strong reservations about the Norman Krasna screenplay, original story by Felix Jackson, and tried to get out of making the picture. Executive producer Pandro S. Berman strong-armed Ginger into the role of store clerk Polly Parrish, who is mistaken for the mother of an abandoned baby. After trying furiously and futilely to explain that the child is not hers, she finally accepts the youngster and the proposal of the store owner, played by David Niven, who was borrowed from Samuel Goldwyn, who has fallen for the little mother in the course of the picture's many hilarious complications. Much of the credit for the film's success belonged to Krasna, the author of the exceptional script that Ginger disliked so intensely, and director Garson Kanin, whose splendid handling of the material established him as the studio's resident wunderkind.
Until Orson Welles.
But Pandro Berman also deserved to take a bow for realizing the potential of the project and forcing Ginger to do it. Since Bachelor Mother was considered a solo vehicle, co-star Niven had not as yet gained top box office status, it boosted Rogers' career more dramatically than any picture since her early musicals with Astaire. B.G. De Silva produced, with a supporting cast that included Charles Coburn, E.E. Clive, Elbert Coplin Jr., who was the baby, Frank Albertson, Ferike Boros, Ernest Truex, Leonard Penn, Paul Stanton, Frank M. Thomas, Edna Holland, Denny Moore, June Wilkins, and Donald Duck, appearing by courtesy of Walt Disney. Bundle of Joy, starring Eddie Fisher and Debbie Reynolds, was a 1957 remake, about which the less said, the better. They don't say that.
You have seen it?
I did see it a long time ago. I don't remember thinking it was very good. Maybe a rewatch is in order one day.
So what could Ginger Rogers... So we know that Ginger Rogers was socially conservative, that she had a nutty Christian Scientist mother, right? But what could she possibly have to object to in this script, which is specifically written so as to avoid... Well, basically, so as to give the story of an unwed mother while avoiding doing so simultaneously.
Well, look, people should do everything they can to see Hollywood the Golden Years, the RKO story, a 6-part documentary, the greatest documentary ever made about a Hollywood studio, made by the BBC during the 1980s, late 1980s, and hosted by Ed Asner, the great Ed Asner. They go into this in depth in episode 3, A Woman's Lot, which is entirely about Katharine Hepburn and Ginger Rogers at the studio. They have numerous interviews with Pandro Berman talking about her issues, and they also have Ed Asner reading some of her correspondence to the studio.
But what are the issues?
The theme is so sordid.
But it's not. I mean, it is, but yeah. It's not. It's like the whole thing has been given a solid veneer of plausible deniability.
Yes, but there's so much sexual double entendre in there that I guess...
But how could she object to that after the double entendres of the Fred Astaire farces, which are worse? Of course, there's not like a whole plot plot built around unwed motherhood, but she's right. She's smart if she's getting the subtext and objecting to it, right?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's it.
But
right?
how can you, either as a moralist or an actress, object to subtext? That's what I wonder.
She did. She could and she did. But Berman, you know, again, this was the end of his tenure, and I guess he used up the last of his clout to force her to make this movie.
But it shows what a great comedian she is, because she delivers all of the smut.
Of course.
She totally delivers it. She's witty. She's, as an actress, she comes across as witty, sophisticated, dry.
Yeah, well, let's not forget, Ginger Rogers made one of her earlier impacts on the American consciousness by singing We're in the Money in Pig Latin. Right? I mean, all those chorus girl roles before the Fred and Ginger era, she was definitely synonymous with sex in the pre-code era. So she just was tired of it? Who knows? But anyway, thankfully she made this movie. It is one of her greatest performances and one of her greatest successes.
Yeah, so we have not buried the lead this time. The point of the movie is to tell a smutty story, a smutty comedy about an unwed mother and then about unwed parenthood in general, when David Niven gets involved, with a veneer of plausible deniability. And that also leads to all sorts of sex jokes throughout the entire thing. And so the audience, you know, the production code is happy. The audience kind of let themselves laugh, but everybody watching this, especially a sophisticated RKO audience, would know that it's filth.
Sure, but it's also extremely trenchant social criticism.
Yeah, it's very progressive filth. It's eating its cake and having it too.
Now, we talked a lot about, you know, the different political characters of the studios, and I think this holds true to form. You know, Warner Brothers is the most consistently proletarian left-wing studio, but RKO is the one that is most likely to combine a gender critique with a class critique. And here you have it in spades, right? You've got exactly how systems of control in a capitalist society and the weight of economic expectation and need impact a woman in a vulnerable position. All of these agencies, these people just talking down to her so maliciously. It's incredible.
At moments, it definitely did remind me, although, yeah, that all of that is much more thoroughgoing, but it did remind me of the Clara Bow It movie. In that case, it's her friend who has the baby, and they both work in the department store, but at a certain point, she does get mistaken for the mother.
Yeah, that's right. One of Ginger Rogers' most amazing qualities gets used here, and it's interesting, right? It's partly the same quality that led her to fight so hard with the studio. Her ability to morally disapprove of things is very strong in her personal life, and it's one of the qualities that she can really project. And when she is forced to just turn her irritation on the entire city administration and all of the different agencies that have power over a woman in her position, it's just wonderful. Her moral superiority... And her anger.
Well, I was going to say, yeah, and also her frank anger.
Exactly. It's so well deployed here.
Never again after the 30s, and I guess some of the same actresses continuing into the early 40s in comedy, will you see women being so frankly angry on the screen? And also it being used in stories and by directors in a way that is... very dramatically and thematically rich, that anger. So many good angers. In the dramatic vein of Crawford and Davis, or in the comedic vein of Rogers and Hepburn and Stanwyck.
Here she gets to lash out at all the people at the foundling home. She gets to lash out at all of her economic persecutors, the people who own the store she works at and gets fired from and rehired willy-nilly.
Let's talk about all this in detail.
Yeah.
Talk about the plot. Also, shout out to the never consistently fully used David Niven, often stuck in thankless other man roles, right? The not romantic lead role. But here he is. This is my third viewing of the movie, and I think this is the first time I noticed just how good his comedic performance is in this.
Yeah, well...
And also how damn attractive he is because of that.
He's wonderful in this movie. We just saw him in 1938 in Dawn Patrol. A very different, but also very funny performance.
Sure, right? But he's also, you know, the other man to Cary Grant's Angel in The Bishop's Wife.
Sure, of course.
And Edward Linton in Wuthering Heights. The ultimate other man.
Yeah, he gets the shaft in that one.
Yeah.
Of course. But his career is, it's inconsistent in terms of the roles that he got, but there are many bright spots along the way. He never really settled into consistent leading roles in Hollywood, right? He goes back and forth. He does a lot of stuff in Britain. A Matter of Life and Death, obviously, is one of the real high spots for him as a romantic lead.
Right. But he's just so damn funny in this. Just so funny.
He is. And a very amusing man in general, right? And late in life, he became a best-selling author of humor books about his experiences in Hollywood. So,
right, and he was real-life buddies with Errol Flynn.
He was.
Which makes that moment when Charles Coburn, as his father in this movie, comments on his staying out late, partying with women and things. That's just such a lovely, light moment between the two of them. With you can just project anything onto that.
Yeah, Niven just says,
infinite.
And things?
but he's totally, he's not denying it. He's like totally admitting it.
It's hilarious, yeah.
It's beautiful, beautiful comedy moment between those two. All right, but what are we talking about in terms of the patronizing attitudes that Ginger Rogers' unwed mother has to face?
Now, Ernest Truex is a really vital part of this film in the first 20 or 30 minutes. He's the guy that is in charge at the foundling home, right, and goes to see the Merlins and shows up at her place on Christmas night with the baby.
Yeah, he's
I am
wonderful.
Not going to inform Mr. Merlin of your attitude. He was a Broadway star, like a big star on Broadway as a milquetoast.
Right.
But in Hollywood, he never got to carry a movie, but this is one of his best roles. He's also amazing in Christmas in July the next year. He is the boss at Dick Powell's coffee company.
Right.
Who finally agrees to give him his shot as an advertising man.
Yeah, that's a key part in the movie.
What do you say, Miss Parrish?
So we start off
Doesn't that infuriate you? It just makes you want to jump in there and beat them all up. What do you say, Miss Parrish?
We start off here with Ginger Rogers working during the holiday season, actually getting her notice that her job is going to end after the holiday season, although we still see a bit of it.
Well, no, it's just the last day. We start on her last day at Merlin and Son.
Yeah.
So she gets into work and she sees her pink slip, basically. And that's an amazing first shot of her, right? Just her body language. We pan up from the notice. Your services will no longer be required. And that's how we meet her. Just her exasperated look.
Wilder uses this and this conversation that ensues with fellow sales girl in Major and the Minor. Really takes off from that aspect of Roger's persona. This girl who's gone to New York and is, in this case, has no family, has nowhere to go, as she says, and is trying to find any kind of work to just stay afloat, just having a very hard time doing that.
Yeah, it's still the Depression. 1939 is still the Depression, right?
Yeah, but it's hard enough at any point to get a menial job and stay afloat with it.
Sure, but never harder than during the 1930s.
Right.
This is a department store film. It's a subgenre all its own that Norman Krasnow really is the master of. He wrote this one. He wrote Devil and Miss Jones. He wrote You and Me, so three of the great movies in that genre. He did not write Miracle on 34th Street, but there are a lot of great department store films from this era. And the department store, as we lose them more and more, we're only going to become more nostalgic about these films, I imagine.
And in this depiction, we get a real sense of its petty hierarchy.
Yes, well, we often get that, right? And Krasnow specializes in that. Certainly, Devil and Miss Jones is very similar in that sense. And we're going to be watching that as part of our upcoming Jean Arthur.
A very late department store movie, Dave, that you and I are going to have to do at some point is Tashlin's Who's Minding the Store with Jerry Lewis.
I'm always open to department store films. Even though it is a modern consumerist wonderland, and certainly at Christmas time, that's not how the film depicts it. The film depicts it as a pretty nightmarish place to be caught in the cogs of, even though the president and owner is making very warm speeches about Christmas.
The merchandise is annoying. All those little wind-up ducks. The quack, 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 quack. The hierarchy is petty. The store doesn't even function to give value to customers, as we learn.
No, and you can't return anything.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's part of what I'm saying.
And yet, the job is obviously better than nothing, so Ginger Rogers wants it, but, the opportunities to move up are limited unless you get really lucky, or you happen to know someone who can pull strings, as Frank Albertson seems to think.
So who is this actor who plays the stock associate?
Well, Frank Albertson. Now,
this is who you're just talking about. So he plays this guy as a unsuccessful adult man who, I mean, it's the Depression, as you say, as just such a perfect creep and without overdoing it. Just your basic creep.
I think he is amazing in this movie. Frank Albertson is a really underrated supporting actor of the era. Probably his four most memorable roles. This is one of them. Alice Adams as Katharine Hepburn's brother.
Right.
He's amazing in that. I'm sure he's best known these days as Sam Wainwright from It's a Wonderful Life. Hee-haw. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And also he plays that guy in Psycho. That's near the end of his career, but the rich guy from Texas that creeps on.
Are you kidding me?
That's him.
So this is like an indelible part of many great movies. He gives exactly what the part requires, obviously. Texas guy. That's a super creep. So in this movie, he's not a super creep. He's just like a basic creep.
Yeah.
And he doesn't have any power.
No, he doesn't. And that's part of the movie takes the time to show you his vulnerability, right? When he loses his promotion, it is a minor tragedy, even though this guy has not really endeared himself to us.
Well, it's not just a minor tragedy. It's a definite allusion to Iago. Doesn't a double life refer to Othello?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that Garson Kanin, he wrote that, didn't he? And Cukor directed it?
That's right.
This is a deliberate allusion on Kanin's part.
Oh yeah, it is. Spending that time with him, sitting there, he's about to cry, he's sitting on the stairs, right? He's finally got this promotion and he gets overzealous about defending the store's interests and gets demoted immediately within a few minutes of getting the job, right?
So this is something to say about Kanin's. It's true of the masters of this period and the people who continue in that tradition, like Billy Wilder for a while, that tonally as a comedy, it's very odd. Tonally, it goes all over the place and gets dark and melancholy at times.
Absolutely. And that's just part of the whole package here that makes it such a memorable, such an impactful film.
So the one good thing that can be said for this store is that at least they have very benevolent, progressive-minded, socially progressive executives or owners.
Do they?
I think we are shown that they do, but that is a double-edged sword.
I'm not sure I would say that, right? I don't think that that's what the movie's saying either. The movie is saying that the Merlins don't really care. They're wishing everyone Merry Christmas while laying half the store off.
Yes, but when they're actually approached by the foundation, that's what I'm talking about. They give this girl her job back and give her a raise.
Yeah, sure. One person.
True, but every company wouldn't do that, Dave.
Well, I'm not sure. I'm not sure we're meant to infer much from that, but...
I think we are, though, aren't we? Like, social attitudes toward unwed mothers are not good. So she actually could just be turned out in the cold, but... What we are shown is that even if they are progressive in that one area, they're certainly not fucking socialists.
Well, no.
But even if they are progressive in that one area, it is in a way that is patronizing.
Yeah, exactly.
And the patronization begins with the foundation itself, who are the same way. They want to help these women, but in a way that thinks of them as sort of sad, pathetic is the word that's used. Pathetic cases of pathos. Not actually obviously being progressive about sex or the way that families are constructed. You know, women's rights, which are connected to those things.
And this is how you get working class conservatism, right? This is how oppressed peoples in an economic system begin to feel like their biggest enemies are mildly benevolent middle managers and government functionaries who are poking their noses into their lives and giving them advice about how to get along, right?
Right. So what do you think? Because I think Kanin is a progressive liberal. So the movie definitely runs a risk there in its depictions. So what do you think about that?
Well, I think it's saying, hey, if you want to actually help people and achieve class harmony, then you better start talking to people in a vulnerable position in a different way. Because talking down to them like this is just going to make them start voting for Donald Trump. Obviously, it hasn't worked. And the whole history of the 20th century shows that they just kept right on behaving the same way. There's got to be a different way. Now, the real different way is socialism and just eliminating all class distinctions entirely. I think that is the only way. I don't know about this liberal, progressive, middle way that was attempted, because it's always going to come with, okay, we're giving you a chance here, rather than you have this as a right.
Sure.
It may be built in to social democracy in a way that is really indicative of inevitable failure for the whole project.
Dave has spoken.
Yeah.
So we get her finding this abandoned baby, abandoned by an older woman.
Yeah, that's great, right? It's her lunch hour. It's just a really miserable day for her. She is wandering the city, trying to figure out what she's going to do with her life. And momentarily, she's pulled out of that because she sees a baby being left on a doorstep, about to roll down some concrete stairs.
Yeah, because we find out later this is a very mobile baby.
Right. And we do see the person leaving the baby. It is not the mother. We're told that the mother doesn't exist anymore. I guess she died. We don't know who that old lady was.
Maybe the grandmother, but who knows? Too poor to look after this child anyway.
Maybe the landlady.
Yeah,
the
or
woman
just not
who died.
Just
yeah.
Not connected enough to it.
But she says it's such a wonderful baby. So Ginger caught on the doorstep by the social workers, and they immediately assume this must be her baby. Why else would she be there? They ask her some questions that she absent-mindedly answers before she realizes that she's now on the hook.
Right, because it doesn't occur to her that no one will believe her if she says that this is not her baby.
Now, I'm not sure what would happen in the real world. Would they do a test to find out if she'd ever given birth?
I was wondering, oh, well, there's that. And there's also, you know, I don't think they have DNA tests at this point.
No, but they could, even at that time, tell whether a woman had
sure,
ever given birth.
Sure, if she agrees to let them examine her vagina, but why would she do that?
Well, if she was trying to get out of legal responsibility for it,
yeah, but
maybe.
they can't even put legal responsibility on her. So all they are doing is they just keep giving her this baby, but they themselves have no way to prove she's the mother. It's a comedy. This wouldn't happen in reality. This is
I know.
Comedy situation, but it's, you know, it has implications.
It does. The proof that they find convincing is that every time she tries to give the baby over to them, it starts to cry. And
right, the baby likes her, so
they have an immediate bond.
Yeah, and or in some magical sense that can only happen in a work of literature, she is the mother.
Right, she becomes the mother right here.
Right, but not through her vagina.
No, and not through any moral transgressions.
Right. So as you're saying, the plausible deniability of this totally implausible comedy setup serves two functions, one of which is that we can imagine all sorts of naughty things going on, which is interesting as a comedic construction, because these are not things that we would think of as naughty now, but because the film is constructed that way, it's still very funny, right?
Of course.
To think of her being the unwed mother, to think, you know, as Frank Albertson thinks, to think of her banging the boss's son every night. And then the other function this serves is to allow Garson Kanin to make a movie about unwed motherhood as a social problem without actually having to do that.
Right.
Because we have seen a movie like that, which is Life Begins.
Right. That was a pre-code, so...
Oh, well, yeah. So that explains it. So they didn't even have to fight to do it. But the truth is that movie, of course, you know, as normally happens when you're treating a social issues movie, is pretty depressing. It's very good, but pretty depressing. Normally you can't make a social issues comedy. There's also that advantage to this movie. Plausible deniability construction.
This initial misunderstanding is just going to proliferate and infect more and more people.
Sure.
The idea that Ginger is the mother and then she gets a father as well.
Like, to a certain extent, like the Preston Sturges misunderstanding comedies, right?
Oh yeah, I think this is in that lineage or at the start of that lineage. It's something I'm sure Sturges would have appreciated.
Yeah. Notably, the most naked construction of that kind. Well, there's Christmas in July, and then there's Hail the Conquering Hero.
Exactly. So she gives up the baby, and she gets to make some righteous speeches against them that fall on deaf ears, right? But we register them, her anger. And it's really nice the way the movie does it. Like, it lets her give full vent to her rage, but it has no effect. These people are made of Teflon, and they just are patronizing no matter what she says. She cannot actually talk them down.
Part of her anger is coming from, it's not actually the anger of an unwed mother who's being patronized, right? It's her anger at the thought that they think that she's an unwed mother.
Exactly, the way the real Ginger Rogers would have thought about such scurrilous accusations.
Right, but it does nevertheless satisfy our desire to see these people get their balls handed to them.
Well, that's right, and she's speaking on behalf of everyone that's ever been patronized by these people. And so they spring into action, and they reason that it must be an economic cause.
Right.
So they
Because what woman would ever want to give up her child?
That's right. So they go to the root of the matter. Ernest Truex finds out immediately that she has indeed been discharged. So that supports his theory. And he intercedes. This is the first day. This is when we meet David Niven as well. He's just had a conversation with his dad about how he was in the Huskow overnight. And he talks about how, hey, there must be something wrong with the Scarsdale police because they don't even accept $100 bribes. So they must be making even more in some other even more corrupt way.
Yeah, somebody just throw away lines like that.
Exactly. And that conversation, you know, where Charles Coburn says, you know, I lived like you and now I look like this.
Oh, that's hilarious.
David Niven says, oh, you look great to me, Dad. I can't wait. It's an amazing script.
Yes. We haven't even really talked about who Garson Kanin is or anything.
Yeah, you looked him up, right? So you've read his life story more recently.
Well, I don't know. I didn't get a lot out of Wikipedia.
I read his Hollywood sort of memoir when I was a teenager. And the only thing I remember from it is that he, when he was a single man, liked to go to a bordello where they had prostitutes who looked like actresses. And he always went to the Barbara Stanwyck.
Well, okay. But he didn't work with her, did he?
No, he was just in love with her from afar.
So Kanin started out as it says here in Wikipedia, jazz musician, burlesque comedian, and actor. And then he made his Broadway debut in 1933. He was cast in a George Abbott play and became Abbott's assistant. Apparently, according to an essay I read and a Letterboxd review that I read, he was very instrumental in George Abbott's career at this point as his assistant, and then became a director at the age of 24 on Broadway. So this is the Wunderkind stuff. And that was in 1936, so obviously he's still pretty young.
He's basically the same age as Orson Welles.
Right, although doing very different kinds of movies and theater. And he continued to direct plays as well, and also wrote screenplays. That's as much as I know about Garson Kanin.
Well, his film directing career is very short, right? It's only for a few years that he actually directs movies, and they're all good. And we're going to do almost all of them in the course of our various Hollywood studio series.
But I don't know if he was kibitzing or if he just couldn't have enough success. It does seem like his movies made money as often as anyone's.
What was his last movie? Was it Tom, Dick, and Harry? Is that really true? That's what I'm thinking.
It looks like it, yeah.
That's crazy, because I'm sure that was a success.
Yeah, who knows? I mean, there are other directors who did theater and just didn't make that many films, like Mamoulian.
Although he does, of course, write screenplays for very successful film.
Writes a very successful Broadway play, Born Yesterday.
Right, yeah.
So yeah, he just had lots of other things to do, I guess.
I mean, I'm sure he goes into it in his memoir, but I don't remember it well enough. I just remember the Barbara Stanwyck anecdote.
Well, I wonder why, Dave. Why did that only thing that stuck in your memory? Back to Bachelor Mother.
She's summoned to the office and David Niven magnanimously offers her her job back. He says, that was a mistake. Sorry about that. We're giving you a raise as well.
So this is a fantastic scene with Ginger Rogers' just stunned reaction. As someone who has had many, many, many menial minimum wage jobs over the years, most often in retail, and had to support myself on them. I feel for her so much in this scene, where she has no idea what's happening. Like, suddenly she's being told by one of the owners of the company that she's going to get her job back and she's going to get a raise for no reason that she can make out. And she's just utterly stunned, and some random guy, I don't know, does she not recognize him from the foundling home?
Well, she didn't talk to him, right? He's sitting in the background watching it.
So she doesn't actually interact with him.
No, the guy she interacts with is a doctor or something, right? But okay. Ernest Truex is like an administrator there.
Yeah, and there's just this other guy who she must think is another executive is just sitting there telling her to say thank you. So that's what she just does over and over again.
Yeah.
And this is the thing about Ginger Rogers, is that she can deliver the anger, but she can also deliver the vulnerability and the uncertainty, right? As she does here.
Yeah, so she's reinstated. She finishes out her day. I guess it's Christmas Eve. Goes home. They've told her she's going to be getting her Christmas present. Now, in the meantime, she had made plans to win a dance contest with Frank Albertson. And all of that is great, too. All the maneuvering that they go through and he sets it all up. You could tell already that he's a bit of a creep, but look, he's just trying to get by. He offers it to her as a plan.
He's literally presented as an average guy.
Exactly. He's got his little scams that he's running, but he's no worse than the next person. He's got a friend on the committee, and so they're going to win the second prize and get $50 to split two ways, which is a lot of money in 1939.
Right.
So that's what she had planned for Christmas Eve.
And this is the kind of thing, of course, people are doing during the Depression, trying to win dance contests.
Yeah, I mean, this seems like a good one, right? Because at least it's not a freaking dance marathon where you have to dance for 8 days, like they shoot horses, don't they?
Yeah.
Which was a big, the derbies, right?
Yeah, that famous story.
But those are real. So this is just, okay, a 1 hour dance contest. It's really about not endurance, but who dances the best.
Right.
And it's nice that she gets a chance to use her dance skills.
In a way, in a comedic way.
Yeah, the baby is brought to her by Ernest Truex.
Yeah.
And she's like, this is not my baby. With the, again, irritation, moral indignation, that he's just not listening.
Well, now they think she is a really
bad woman.
An inhuman mother, yes. Because there's no way that she could possibly want this child that they think that she's had accidentally, right? If she has the economic means to take care of it. And of course, overall, that is true of women, but it's also true in many cases that if you have a child that you didn't want, you still don't want it.
That's right.
Because, you know, your body is doing a thing here, pregnancy, that you don't actually ask it to do.
Yeah, seems reasonable to me, but not to Ernest Truex. He just says, I'm leaving now, and I'm not going to tell anyone that you said these terrible things because you need that job, and now I'm really regretting doing anything for you.
These are their limits, right? They will pity a woman who's gotten into this position until they learn that she actually really doesn't want the child, and then she is a bad woman.
He says, go ahead, bring it back to the family home, but it's only going to be brought right back to you. I don't know if that could possibly really be the case. I don't actually know what... Were there laws against abandoning a baby that you could take care of? I have no idea. I don't think so, right? Women must have had the right to give up a baby for adoption, so I'm not sure if an institution like this could really get away with continually stalking her with her baby. But again, the movie, I'm sure it felt like this, whether this was the actual rubber hitting the road truth of the matter in terms of the legal regime.
The social disapproval, even with society at its most progressive on the issue, the disapproval of you for not wanting children, for ending up pregnant, etc.
Exactly. So this conveys the felt reality
for
a woman in 1939.
Well, many decades beyond that.
Well, yeah, definitely. She's left with the baby. She can't do anything tonight anyway.
Right, and then the farce snowballs more as she decides, well, this is all David Niven's fault.
Right, when Albertson shows up and he has a car, she's like, okay, well, the Merlins, it's their fault, let them deal with it. And of course, they're more powerful than Ernest Truex, so if the Merlin family says, no, you have to take this baby back and give it to someone who wants to adopt a baby, well, they'll have to just swallow it, right?
Right.
So she forces Albertson to drive her to the mansion of the Merlins.
And whoever this butler is, he was very funny.
Oh, E.E. Clive. He often played a butler. Yes, he's great. Albertson is becoming very squeamish now because this guy, as much as he likes to mack on his female co-workers,
he doesn't want any direct involvement with the boss because
he's scared.
He knows that can only go wrong. And this is the owner of a giant company. It's not your manager. It's not your small business owner.
Genuine terror in his eyes. He's like, You said you were feeling like you were going to have a headache. Well, now I do. She's like, oh, come on. Let's go win this contest, right?
Yeah, because she's just so fucking mad at all of this patronization.
Yeah, and they go to the Pink Slipper, where the contest is on, and this is a great 30s vignette.
And Niven and Butler and Baby follow them.
And they get to see the spectacle of Ginger dancing the Big Apple at certain points, doing the
finger pointing.
Yeah.
Hilarious social comedy in this scene, because Niven, the rich playboy, shows up, and automatically these bouncers identify him as a troublemaker. Because he doesn't mix with the crowd, right?
No, he just tries to order people around and they're not listening, right? And he has to follow the rules. If he wants to go out onto the dance floor, he has to dance out there with a hostess.
But he doesn't do it well. He just drags her across the floor.
Boy, was he corny.
Yeah. So he cannot fit in democratically with this crowd.
No, he feels like he doesn't have to. He's actually thrown out of the club.
Yeah, and he looks great with his floppy hair. Sexy.
He's undaunted, right? So now it's a battle of wills. So he's going to just stalk her now and wait at her house.
But interestingly, given all that we've said about her righteous anger, he's going to win. He wins.
Well, yeah, because he's got too much power, right?
Yeah, the plot requires him to win, of course, but within the text, it is power, and she just, at a certain point, just gives in. He just berates her so much, and she has nothing left.
Well, again, he doesn't just berate her. He threatens her with all of the might of his economic clout. He says, anyone in the Merchants Association will blackball you. I will see to it.
This is persecution, she says, but she, you know, Barbara Stanwyck would just keep yelling to the end, but Ginger, at a certain point, admits defeat.
Right, well, that's realistic. She cannot fight the Merchants Association.
Yeah.
And he knows that. Now, he lays it all out, and then he turns away from her, and he says, are you going to beg for your job back now? And, of course, she has to.
Right, and it's wonderful the way David Niven delivers that, because we see that even though he has exercised his power like a bully, he still is ultimately good-hearted.
Well, he is, right, but again, only on his terms. Like, that's what we're seeing throughout this. All of these benevolent figures are only willing to help if you do things their way. But yeah, she's stuck. She has to do it. And along the way, we meet Farike Boros, the landlady, who becomes instrumental here, because if she's going to be a single mother, someone's got to be watching that baby, and it's going to be her landlady, her kindly landlady. We've seen her earlier this year in Warner Brothers 1939. She plays the candy shop owner in Dust Be My Destiny that John Garfield plans to rob and then decides not to, obviously.
Right, and she and her son are textually Jewish. They are even given the name.
The Weiss family. I mean, she is such a wonderful actor. Heartbreaking. Like, every time she speaks, you want to start to cry. I mean, you see her a lot, but this is maybe her most wonderful role. She's also in Christmas in July, though. It's a lot of overlap with Christmas in July.
Yeah, she seems to have had a very extensive stage career that started in Hungary. She also was on the stage in London and then New York. So she's in A Tree Grows in Brooklyn.
Oh, yeah. She's the grandmother in that. That's amazing. That's right.
She's in all sorts of things in film. She's uncredited in Make Way for Tomorrow, apparently. She's uncredited a fair bit in film.
She always makes an impact, but I never knew her name until I actually looked at the credits this time.
Very experienced stage actress who ends up playing all these character roles in endless movies, but often uncredited. So that's how it worked in Hollywood.
When did she die?
1951.
Okay.
At the age of 77.
Now we get some vignettes of Ginger just trying to live this double life of mother and shop girl.
I guess maybe the landlady is the character we see who is genuinely the least judgmental.
So of course, she's the one who reacts the way we wish everyone would.
Although it's also true that Ginger does not try to deny that she's the mother to her.
Well, no, she doesn't. But she doesn't have to, because the landlady doesn't judge her at all, right? All she says is, oh, you thought maybe I wouldn't let you stay here? Of course I'm going to let you stay here. And she doesn't say anything else about it.
Right.
She doesn't say, oh, even though you're bad, I'm going to let you stay here. She says nothing about
it. And offers to help her. Just out of her own goodwill.
Yeah, exactly.
So, because how else is... She's not going to be able to afford childcare, so...
That's right. That's right. You need
a
caretaker.
How are they expecting her to even have this job?
Well, that's what I'm saying. Nobody makes any provision for that. It's like, well, you shift for yourself. See if that extra $5 a week, how far that goes. I don't think there was any kind of $5 daycare in place in New York State at that time. So.
Nor is there now.
Well, there is in Quebec.
Generally, there is not.
I think it's $15, but $15 now is a lot less than $5 in 1939.
Some provinces are better than others for low-income families, although I've never seen a single mother manage daycare without the specific help of her employer.
Well, no, in Quebec, you can't.
It's still a problem. Daycare, even for well-employed couples, is still a problem. Let's just say that.
Yeah, of course.
But how this woman is supposed to do it, I have no idea.
And how she's supposed to even function at work with...
No sleep.
And David Niven's like, oh yeah, you mothers make it all seem like such a mystery.
But... When I was six, I figured out that you're just trying to get attention.
Yeah, but she really does look pretty badly off. She can't keep her her eyes open while she's winding those ducks.
And this is where we get Frank Albertson assuming that she's banging David Niven.
Exactly. So he's like, hey, could you, you know, whisper something in the Merlin's ear about how I'm due for a promotion? I'd like to get out of this stock clerk role and wear a carnation. It's the dream of his life.
Yeah, like Pepe in Shop Around the Corner wanting to get promoted from delivery boy to sales clerk.
They're kind of similar characters, except we don't see Pepe try to get in for a little date rape.
Well, Pepe would totally do date rape. Do you not remember that character? He's always going on about the girls.
And we just don't see it in action. Yeah. So it's a little bit more flagrant when you see Frank Albertson, hey, why don't you ask me in for a drink? Why don't you ask me in for a cigarette?
Oh yeah, we didn't actually cover that moment. And again...
But that's pretty amazing for a movie at this time to do this, right?
Again, this is Ginger Rogers showing her vulnerable side, that she actually isn't able to convince him to not come in. The expression on her face when he does get in is so great, that shot of her face, which is just exasperation. She isn't afraid of being date raped, but she's just like, it's gonna take me an hour to get this idiot out of my house.
It's terrible. Now, fortunately for her, or unfortunately, that's where Niven is waiting for them, and that proves to be great Frank Albertson repellent.
He goes running out of there.
Oh, wait a minute.
And of course he assumes that the only reason she doesn't want to have sex with him is because she's having sex with David Niven.
Right, right. Now, she doesn't do anything about Albertson's suggestion. There's not even time for her to even process it, because it turns out that he was up for the promotion anyway. And we get that little irony going on behind the scenes.
But this all happens after the scene where Niven comes and tries to mansplain. Oh, and again, this is not... You're right. Like, this is normal for RKO to be modern on gender like this.
Yeah, they're the studio.
It's not that you never see it in the other studios, but yeah, they're pretty consistent on it. It's not the norm for a movie of this period, where he's not just personally mansplaining motherhood to her, parenting, but he's got a book by a man that he keeps referring to, that obviously this man, because he wrote this book and
he's a pediatrician, yeah.
Yeah, and is a doctor and everything else, obviously he's going to know how to take care of a baby better than a woman will.
That's right.
Who has nothing to offer other than the fact that she is in fact taking care of the infant. Said other than the fact that women have been looking after infants for generations.
He pulls out the book. He's like, how do you know you're feeding the baby correctly? And of course, there are two pages stuck together and he winds up giving her insane advice. You know, the punchline is the best, where she says, well, if it had said hang baby by neck, you would have been fine with that too. His discomfiture as he is shot down in his efforts to bring pediatric wisdom to this young mother. He breaks the duck, and that leads to, again, it's a wonderful sequence where first he tries to convince her that it's going to be fine, it's easy to return, and she says, ha ha. That's one of my favorites.
It's also the final sound of the movie.
Comes back. She says, oh, there's only one problem with our exchange department. They don't exchange anything. And he says, I'm going to show you. And he goes incognito with the duck, and immediately everything just starts going awry.
Right, until he decides to just act like an entitled idiot again.
Even though he's such a likable character, ultimately, right? You do like David Niven in this movie, but every step of the way, we're shown what a different world he lives in, and every time he tries to pretend like he's a normal person, or go anywhere where normal people go...
Yeah, because he just decides that
it's infuriating.
Again, his problem is not being able to follow the rules, because he just decides that if they won't exchange it for him, he's going to steal all the ducks.
That's right. He starts just throwing the ducks all over the place. It's really crazy.
And stuffing some in his pocket.
Yeah. He's just looking for the one that's not going to break if he winds it too tight.
And then Albertson, who is either too aggressive for this role, or too green, or has not been properly instructed, assaults him. Which at first I was wondering, like, can you actually touch a thief, a customer thief at this point? Because you sure can't do it in retail now. But no, you can't, because David Niven points out that if I were a customer, I would be suing the store.
Yeah, that's right.
But I guess maybe it's not... I don't know whose job it's supposed to be to stop a thief here. I don't know if it's the floorwalker's job and he's just overzealous because he wants to prove himself.
Well, yeah, that's exactly what it is. We've seen throughout this man is driven by insecurity. And again, that's the pathos of the Albertson character, that it's easy to dislike him because as soon as he gets that carnation, he starts going around barking orders at everyone to shut up and stop gossiping, etc. All the stuff that he used to do the day before, he is now now coming down like a hammer on everybody and making everyone hate him, right? And he's like, well, that's what I have to do. That's what management does. He's not wrong, because we've seen how the other people behave that are even higher up on the totem pole than him.
But unfortunately, he just gets this ridiculous dramatic incident very early in his new role.
Yeah, and he
can't handle it.
Instant demotion. And that's when he has that near tearful breakdown.
You've disgraced the toy department.
It's rough. And of course, yes, he determines to get revenge at that point. I know where the bodies are buried, see? And he's got that
patter.
He snaps his fingers when he's about to do something dramatic. Does it a few times. He's just really going for it in this movie and delivers in a really memorable way. And of course, it's not the last time he'll do it, because everyone remembers Hee-Haw Sam Wainwright.
Yep. Well, he sure went for it in that.
He does. He always has this kind of ambiguous role in the movies, right? Because he's a person that Jimmy Stewart's not that happy with throughout the movie, but on the other hand,
he's kind of obnoxious.
He is, but he's also on the side of our hero, ultimately.
Yeah, I mean, he's very, obviously playing a very different kind of character, an extremely successful character, not a failure.
Born to it, right, too. That's the other thing.
Right. So let's get through the rest of this story, though. Basically, at this point, it turns into a love story until the comedy comes back with this revenge plot.
Yeah, but the New Year's Eve stuff is amazing. It's so good. This really is an essential holiday film. You've got the Christmas department store and a lengthy scene on New Year's Eve. And, great stuff in Times Square, waiting for midnight to strike.
Right, and they're getting separated by the crowd, the mob.
And the kiss is great, the build-up to it. But even before that, the whole dinner sequence, he had a date with Astrid Alwyn, but he just neglected to follow up on planning it. And so she says, well, David, I made another date. I'm sorry. And so this gives him his opportunity to, oh, well, of course, Polly, the unwed mother, will have nothing to do. I'll just go whisk her off to a fancy dinner.
Well, he thinks she'll have nothing to do, including looking after the baby. Right. So it's more of his entitlement.
Of course, exactly, right? He's forced this on her, but then he's like, oh, come on, don't be such a drag. Your baby. But again, the landlady steps into the breach and he becomes the fairy godmother, asking his employees to bring all of the fancy clothes she'll need to go to this posh event. But she, again, not confident in upper class settings. She doesn't want to talk at all. And he's like, oh yeah, we can fix that. And the pretense that she is a Swedish manufacturer's daughter, they get a lot of mileage out of that. Again, I feel like it's a nice, maybe not subtle commentary on the fact that these guys love the fact that it's a beautiful woman they don't even have to talk to.
Right.
They just won't leave her alone. She doesn't get a chance to eat one bite of the dinner because she's dancing the entire time.
Well, and even when they first arrive, he introduces her to a friend that he describes as a masher, basically.
Yeah, all wolf.
Right. They're all half man, half wolf, except this guy who is all wolf.
Right. And he's like, hey, you said hi to me. That's me over here. You're looking the wrong way. She finally has had enough. She actually needs to eat, and she's missed all the food. The waiters keep taking the food away. And when they leave, they have a confrontation with Astrid Alwyn, where Ginger Rogers gets to make a joke that maybe doesn't play as well now in a more enlightened era on gender, but she basically calls Astrid Alwyn a man.
Yes, that's true.
You could go stag with those shoulders.
David Niven definitely thinks it's very funny.
He thinks it's hilarious. He goes full Dawn Patrol there, laughing wildly like a hyena, like when he comes back from being shot down. And of course, it's the first time she's spoken the entire night, and it is just a complete shock to everybody. So, and they do their double talk fake language that's supposed to be Swedish, right? Mm-hmm. Trobshaw, he says at one point.
Well, she just keeps doing variations on Swedish men's names.
Smorgas.
Well, and that.
Smorgas for a very nice evening. Then they go to Times Square. They have their big kiss. It's all been leading up to this, and it delivers, right? The emotions feel earned. When they get back home and he kisses her again, he wants to start making plans for tomorrow, but hey, there's still the baby to consider. And he's like, oh, right, you're an unwed mother.
Well, he's all over the place because we've seen that he's an irresponsible playboy. Then he takes this very strong interest in the baby, actually in helping her with the baby, although he goes about it in
a patronizing way.
Patronizing, heavy-handed way. But then as soon as he starts seeing her as a sexual being, once the baby stuff is settled, he doesn't want anything to do with the baby. So we get a little bit of a few obstacles there in terms of him kind of being a step behind her in maturity the whole time.
Well, yeah, but again, he's reflecting social attitudes. He's taken a benevolent interest in her and her quote-unquote baby. They're becoming friends, but now he kind of is starting to feel not just like, oh, I want to have a fling with her, I'm falling in love with her, I don't like thinking about the fact that she's actually had sex before.
Well, I don't think it's so much that. It's
taking, it is that.
I don't think so. I think it's taking on the responsibility of the child.
No, I think it's more than that. I think he's thinking, oh, this woman is tarnished.
Well, we're going to have to disagree there, because I think it's entirely about not wanting to take on the child.
I think it's both. I think the movie really does communicate that, and that's why she takes offense, right? When he starts talking that way.
Well, I don't know. I didn't think that's what she was taking offense at. I thought she was just taking offense at the fact that he's basically indicating that he just wanted to have sex with her and not make a commitment that includes this ready-made family.
Yeah, but not on that New Year's Eve night, because the New Year's Eve night, he's starting to make plans for them as if, yeah, this is the first serious romance of his life, and he really wants to marry her, and then he's reminded that, no, she's not marriageable, because she's already tarnished.
I see, but we're disagreeing on that, because I think it's all about just not wanting to be the father to a baby that he didn't father.
Okay, well...
And this is very much a thing that is, you know, you see it in other movies, more contemporary movies, women, and I don't know, I've read about it in magazines and stuff, women who already have a child and trying to find somebody who wants to date them under those circumstances. My own mother was a single mother, and, you know, her solution was to ended up marrying somebody who already had a child, so understood that experience, right?
Mm, sure.
And it's the baggage. It's the baggage that the men don't want.
But I still think you're thinking of it in too presentist a term, because that is how men would think of it now, presumably, but in 1939, especially in a movie, it's more loaded than that. That's my opinion. You know, we've got our Discord if you want to take a side on this, please do. It's great when we disagree a little here. So
it doesn't really matter. I just don't see textual evidence of what you're talking about. That's all. So it may just be pure interpretation, not based on anything, just projecting what we each think is going on. Based on, and in my case, based on, like I said, other movies I've seen, personal experience, blah, blah, blah.
The revenge plot really takes over, and the grandfather gets fully involved, the pseudo-grandfather, Charles Coburn. And this is one of his earlier roles, and he's going to become an actual star in Hollywood in the 40s, late in life. He's an amazing actor, always great at projecting high-spiritedness and kind of weird sternness, and he can really do these things together in a way that almost nobody else can. Probably the apex of his career is The More the Merrier, but Devil and Miss Jones is also. So he and Jean Arthur have some great moments together in a lot of movies.
And of course he's instrumental in The Lady Eve.
Of course. Got a lot of great stuff coming up, and this is just a preview of coming attractions. He's hilarious in this movie. When he gets this letter, this anonymous letter from a friend, you stuff shirt from Frank Albertson, he's delighted.
Yeah, and the wording of that letter that we get to look at, where it's so aggressive, and then he kind of sort of mitigates the aggression. He sticks a mister in there with a, you know, a little arrow and
yeah.
In the name.
He's eyeing David Niven. He's delighted to know that there is this grandson in the world, or grandchild in the world.
Well, yeah, you can just read so much backstory into this from his performance mainly, which is just this, he's obviously very disappointed in this son that he can't expect to settle down anytime soon, and he would like him to already be settled down with a family.
David Niven tries to get away from his dad so that he can go see Ginger Rogers in the park. She's let it be known that she will be in the park.
Right, and he was hesitant about joining her after she mentioned that the night before, after he remembered the baby would... He can't just run off with her and do whatever he wants. The baby has to be taken care of. But then he comes around and joins her. But they immediately get into an argument again.
Yeah, there's a lot of nice stuff in this park scene, right? It does show Niven becoming more democratic. You know, he holds the water fountain for her, and then he holds it for that little guy, too.
Well, yeah, and then there's this whole long bit of business about the water fountain between the two men.
Yeah, it's funny. Classic mother who overinflates the value of their own child. There's like a debate there that goes on. And we see this little kid who is just not a very prepossessing...
Oh, but that ridiculous shot of the kid?
Yeah, who looks really out of it. Like, Junior can stand.
That shot comes after the mother saying, "Our doctor says that Junior is a perfect physical specimen."
Yeah, exactly. Now, Ginger goes overboard herself and starts claiming that the baby can talk. We know that's not true. And David Niven makes it completely ridiculous by saying that the baby can recite the first line of Gunga Din.
So they don't really win this exchange at
all. No, they come out looking like fools.
And then they start bickering.
Yeah, and then Charles Coburn shows up and he tears up. He sits down. When he finds out the baby has his name, he's like, at least you've done that.
Yeah, and that was by total accident. Wasn't she trying to name the baby Joan and then she didn't realize it was a boy?
Well, yeah, it sounded like she was just guessing at a name that maybe she could change if she had to, right? And it worked out for her. It was John. So this is John Merlin. He is smitten with this baby and he wants it. And then they go home and they have that screaming match over breakfast the next day, right? The bits of business with the spoon.
Well, yeah, you're talking about the father and son.
Exactly. Every time. So the butler keeps coming in, tries to give him a spoon. The spoon gets thrown again by Charles Coburn as he insists the baby must be taken into the Merlin home.
So now David Niven is getting a taste of his own medicine.
Exactly.
That no one will believe that he didn't knock up this woman.
In the movie's logic, it's an unfalsifiable position. Right, as soon as you're accused, you are guilty of being the parent of this child.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Unfortunately, it doesn't work for grandparents.
They have to find some way out of it, and everyone's trying to figure it out. Now, the inciting event for that is when David Niven shows up at Ginger's house. This is where he makes his biggest gaffe, right? And they have their momentary cooling where he says, "My father's gone insane. He even wants me to marry you with a ready-made family," right? Yeah, so there, yes, I agree with you that that's what he's objecting to completely. And she really takes that badly,
right,
and tells him to leave.
The way I read that is that it becomes evident to her that he's... Well, it's interesting. It's interestingly complex. It becomes evident to her that he's only been thinking of her in a sexual way. But it's not true. It's just that he hasn't processed all of his feelings, basically.
Yeah, well, he hasn't...
Because he's more immature.
That's right. He hasn't thought about how his life will change.
Sure.
If they get involved. That's what it comes down to. And she's
right,
like,
and
okay.
I guess, yeah, and she's already accepted that this baby is part of her life, so she doesn't have to make as much of an adjustment.
That's right. So she says, "Get out." And when Ginger says, "Get out," you know, it's...
Yeah, and it's interesting because she says it very softly, but she really means it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He's told off, but good. Then we come up with the ruse of the two fathers, the two fake fathers. Now, she's previously, because she's been forced to, right, because they wouldn't accept any other story from her, she had to accept responsibility for having born this child, and so there has to be a father, and she says, "I don't want anything to do with him. He hit me in the head with a coffee pot." So now, any father she produces, David Niven is going to believe is a wife beater.
Although, hilariously, at the time, when she starts telling this whole sad story, he doesn't want to hear it. He doesn't want to get that involved, and he, at the coffee pot point, is when he's like, "Okay, going home now, going to bed."
That's right.
Give a little pat on the back. I'm all done here.
Obviously, it has remained in his mind.
Well, and I mean, now that he's in love with her, obviously this has come back to haunt him.
Yeah. So it's the landlady's son that she gets, and Niven goes and gets Frank Albertson to pretend to be the father. And of course, they both show up at the same time. Charles Coburn is momentarily knocked back in his plans, but
so I guess, you know, from the perspective of the wholesome Ginger Rogers, we're presented with an endless amount of unsavory scenarios by which this woman got pregnant.
That's right. It turns into a giant fiasco. Charles Coburn exultantly yelling, "I don't care who the father is, I'm the grandfather."
Why would she be hiding the fact that she's married at work just so that she can get a job as a woman at all?
Well, exactly. No, yeah. That is perfectly true. That, of course, if they were going to lay people off, they would always lay off married women first.
Right.
So if you wanted to keep your job, you did not tell anyone you were married,
so
if you could help it.
Blink and you'll miss it, but more Depression era social and gender commentary.
Yeah, absolutely. And the Merlins take that. Okay, well, of course, that makes sense. That... We would fire you if you were married. So Coburn triumphant once again. And meanwhile, Niven just goes after this poor little guy who's just trying to help out. Everything goes crazy.
Right. And then Charles Coburn gets...
his lawyers.
Yeah, but he gets very heavy-handed. And once again, now we're faced... The whole beginning of the movie is that this baby is being forced on this woman.
That's
by
right.
Institutions, by people with more power than she has. And now she's going to have it taken away from her the same way.
Well, exactly, right? So a woman in the position Ginger Rogers Rogers is in, just has no control over any aspect of her life. She's completely a pawn of economic clout. If it's an unwanted baby, they'll force her to take care of it. And if it's a all of a sudden becomes a baby that has some value in the eyes of rich people, she cannot keep it, no matter what she wants. So it's established that it's her baby, and then, they won't let her keep it anyway.
Right, okay, so it starts out with this employer and this foundling home, social workers basically, telling her, okay, you've got a job, you've got a raise, you can look after this child, so you must. And now she's going to be told, you can't look after the child, you're not fit.
No, that's right. You were dancing when you were supposed to be taking care of your baby. Forget it. This rich person who wants your baby can have it.
So yeah, there is so much social commentary just massaged into the movie.
And of course, this has some resonance with Great Man Votes as well. Yeah. So we'll talk about that in the second half. But it all ends well. Ginger decides she must run away. The Merlin intervene in time.
And there's a Donald Deus Ex Machina.
Yep, exactly. The duck comes to the rescue by bringing Ginger and Niven together.
And then he lets her know that he's decided to marry her. So yeah, that solves it all in fairy tale / Hollywood narrative terms.
And again, she brings out this final irony for us. She says, you still think I'm the mother of that baby? And he's like, well, of course. That is really daring, right? Because, sure, the audience knows, as you say, there's plausible deniability there. But Niven is saying, okay, it makes sense for a pillar of the community, a really, you know, an upper-class person like David Niven's character to marry an unwed mother, and this is all fine.
Well, only because his father thinks that this is, in fact, his child.
Yeah, exactly. But again, you don't get a lot of movies from 1939 ending with any of the parties to a proposal thinking that there's a bastard involved. That is kind of kept out of narratives from this era. Not in this movie.
In its sort of subtler way, it really is a precursor in some ways to the Sturges 40s movies.
Oh, yeah.
But it's better disguised as just a romantic comedy, quote unquote.
Garson Kanin, a genius.
And a huge hit.
Yeah, their biggest hit of the 30s, apparently.
Wow.
And did this come out before or after Great Man Votes?
Came out in June 39. Great Man Votes came out in January 39.
Okay, so that's nice for Kanin.
Great Man Votes lost $10,000. Bachelor Mother had a profit of $827,000.
Exactly. So we're doing them in the reverse order. In actual fact, Garson Kanin had this flop and then came roaring back with the biggest hit of the 30s. But we're going to talk about the flop next. So, from the RKO story, our synopsis of The Great Man Votes. John Barrymore returned to RKO after a long absence to make The Great Man Votes. His career was in decline, and his physical condition had deteriorated enormously in only a few years, which, ironically, made him the perfect actor to play the role of Gregory Vance in this Cliff Reid production. Vance is a former Harvard educator and a published scholar whose ambition has dissolved since the death of his wife, and who has become a lush. He works as a night watchman and takes care of his two extraordinary children, played by Peter Holden and Virginia Weidler. Assisted by their teacher, Catherine Alexander, the pair inspire their father to regain his self-respect by casting the decisive ballot in the mayoralty election. With this film, Garson Kanin again demonstrated that he deserved recognition as RKO's most promising young director. The suspenseful and heartwarming screenplay was written by John Twist from a story by Gordon Malherbe Hillman. Donald McBride, Benny Bartlett, Brandon Tynan, Elizabeth Risden, Granville Bates, Louis Alberni, J.M. Carrigan, and William Demarest were also featured. So not a word here about how it lost money, but obviously they liked the movie, and of course so do I. So
I found a long review of this on Letterboxd by Rick Buren, noted Letterboxd reviewer, and also a blog post by Spymasher1942.
Okay.
On something called parkridgeclassicfilm.com. I'll put that on the Discord.
Cool.
They repeat some of the same information. Both of them emphasize that along with Mitchell Lysen's Midnight,
yep,
which has a Billy Wilder script, this is one of the last great roles that Barrymore had. But it's almost one of the last roles that Barrymore had. There's not a lot of life left after this. He dies in 1942. So yeah. It's not like he went on for a decade doing self-parodies. He went on for two or three more movies, and that's it. So all in all, it's not bad how Hollywood used him in the late 30s, considering what a state he was in.
Yeah, he just wanted to be drunk all the time, so they let him play characters that are like that. But they also let him use the skills he still had. I mean, this movie, this performance is remarkable.
Yeah, this is maybe the movie he made that... Well, no, it's not. Several of his roles, even from the early 30s, comment on him autobiographically, right?
Sure, Dinner at Eight is already headed in that direction. That's when he's at the height of his stardom, really.
But here he is playing a man who there is a gap between who he is and what he could have been.
Yeah.
And that's his whole character.
A meringue pie.
And not only that, but playing a drunk.
Yeah, when we meet him, he is finishing off his shift at the factory or whatever he's doing as a night watchman. And he judges the time by the amount of liquid left in his hard liquor bottles. And he's right on the money. He looks at the little trickle left and he says, it's about 7 o'clock. And then the clock rings 7 o'clock. Steady alcohol intake throughout his waking hours.
Based on my reading here, apparently he was very, very difficult to work with at this point. He had to walk on eggshells. He was reading his lines off of chalkboards.
Yeah.
He was apparently jealous of... Who do you think he'd be jealous of in the cast, Dave?
The kids?
Well, particularly Virginia Weidler.
Sure, she's a great actress.
Yeah, she's probably the most precocious child actor I've ever seen. Famous for her Philadelphia Story role. Inundo!
She's excellent always. I think her last role is like 1943, 44, so she didn't really transition to adult roles. She's in a Mickey and Judy movie, Babes on Broadway.
But as with Ginger Rogers and her whatever dumb issues she had in real life, none of this shows. He is so likable in this role,
yeah,
and lovable with the kids, despite looking like he's reeking of alcohol. Like, I've seldom seen a leading man who is allowed to look like this.
Well, we've talked about it at times.
He is so seedy.
Yeah, there will be a scene at the end of a movie where a character who is broken will look like this. Like Charles Boyer, right? Or like Jimmy Cagney at the end of Roaring Twenties. But this is from beginning to end until he gets into his parade clothes briefly. He just looks totally fucked up.
Yet he's still weird. This is like quite a few years on from 1934's 20th Century, but he's still hopping and jumping around. We were commenting on that too with that of the Carol Lombard movie, True Confessions. How ridiculously spry he still is considering his condition.
Well, he's too drunk to feel the aches.
That's why it's a surprise when he has trouble getting on the wagon at the end.
So he's in his late 50s here. I mean, he's not old by normal standards, but just the life he's been living the David Niven life.
Well, he doesn't even look older than that. He just looks like a wreck.
Yeah, exactly.
But here that is put to good dramatic use.
And it's important the setting is 1923 in some American town, right? It's not stated where, just an urban area controlled by the Democrats.
Right, so why don't you talk just a little bit, Dave, just a little bit. Why don't you talk about the political aspect of the movie, the historical political aspect.
It's a critique of machine politics, right? And most urban machines were Democratic run. And it's important, they're setting it in the past, which I think is crucial, right? This is the pre-New Deal Democratic Party, which stands for nothing. No party stood for anything in the 20s, and this movie makes maximum use of that. There's no reason to vote for one or the other.
Oh, we should point out, in terms of, I guess, Kanin's own politics, we do see an integrated school.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And that's not very usual for movies at this time. We forgot to mention, actually, the integrated street children on the street in Dean Martin's really wonderful and charming big solo number in Artisan Models.
Yeah, that's true.
But that's much later.
Much later. Yeah. In the 30s, you get this in Capra movies and RKO movies. America is a real broad spectrum of people, not just European kids. Although, of course, all of our main characters are European descent, but...
Right, but just to see Black people presented as normal and not as maids or caricatures.
Right.
worth remarking on.
Yeah, in the context, it is a statement, obviously. And again, you could do that at RKO because they didn't really have any theaters in the South, so didn't have to worry about that. These kids, they go to a regular public school in whatever town this is. They're not getting such a great education.
Well, not by Barrymore's former Harvard professor standards.
He's a historian. I always liked this from the start. This is a movie, I talk about this a bit on the Discord. I'm going to keep flogging our Discord. It's a movie I read about in the Leonard Maltin Guide. High praise for it in Maltin, and even higher praise for it probably in John Springer's Forgotten Films to Remember, an amazing book that I read religiously and kept handy so that I could make judgments about what movies to tape off of PBS when I was a kid. This movie just always seemed like I was going to love it, but it just never would come on TV. Finally, in 1995, I found the TV listing for when it actually showed on the Plattsburgh PBS station. And by then I was living, you know, with my girlfriend on my own, and I had to arrange to have it taped at my dad's because we didn't get any channels. I did get it though, and I had it on a tape. And when I finally watched it, it was as good as I dreamed it would be. Just so many great little things in it to start with. So Barrymore has a good relationship with the bootlegger, Louis Alberni, who has a milk truck that he uses as his cover.
Yeah.
He's got little kittens. It's a very friendly bootlegger. And it's the Rosebud Company. It's the same sign, too. It's the same illustration that's on the Rosebud sled, spoiler alert, in Citizen Kane.
I'm sure this is part of the public record, but I'm just wondering if Kanin and Orson Welles knew each other.
From RKO.
Well, no, but also from theater. Kanin and Orson Welles, as two very different kinds of wunderkinds, could have known each other from the Broadway theater.
Yeah, I'm sure. They traveled in the same circles. They worked at the same studio. 1940, 41, etc., right? So who knows? They just had this Rosebud design lying around and Welles decided to put it on a sled and the rest is history. But it started on the side of a milk truck in 1939. We get a little glimpse at life with this little family. He's trying to teach them a little more in depth about what Julius Caesar was reporting back on his exploits in Britain.
Right, and obviously these kids are really precocious, living with this father, but they express themselves in slangy ways and malapropisms.
The pickets and the scotch. I mean, Barrymore's got so many great lines in this movie, too. And I mean, written specifically for him to say. Sometimes I wonder if you learned your English in school or at a longshoreman's clam bake. I mean, it's just endless quotable lines in this movie, written by John Twist.
And Wikipedia says Garson Kanin uncredited, which I'm sure is the case for all of his movies.
Yeah, I think so. Obviously, he was a great screenwriter, so he threw things in, and no doubt he wanted to get maximum impact from having John Barrymore.
Whatever the truth of these lines on chalkboard, that must have been a big chalkboard for these lines. You certainly can't detect that.
No, he's a great actor, and whether he can remember lines anymore or not, as long as he has access to them somehow, he makes them count. So the kids, we see how this plays out in the classroom. You know, they know more than anyone else. The teacher, they have a new teacher, Catherine Alexander. I love this actress. She's one of my favorite supporting actors in Hollywood. And this is probably her biggest role, but she's everywhere.
Yeah, it's not a very big role.
No, but she really makes an impact. And she's the love interest for John Barrymore.
Sort of, yeah.
Well, they're together by the end. We don't see a lot of it.
No.
But there's a developing attraction there.
In terms of RKO and gender, this is an interesting movie. The whole assumption of the story is patriarchal. And it's really emphasized. It's made obvious by the fact that Virginia Weidler, as Joan, is this brilliant and tomboyish little girl who's nevertheless playing out this gendered script where she's going to be the wife-like support to the great man. And she plays that to the hilt. She in no way questions it.
Well, yeah, but there is some underlying critique there, right? That these women, they're basically forced into that role by men who refuse to be practical. Now, that's maybe an idiosyncratic take on gender, but that's what the movie
is. No, it's not. No, I've certainly seen that trope.
I mean, it's more common now, I think.
You can do any kind of binary with gender, right? They're probably all out there somewhere, and one of them is that women are down-to-earth and practical, and men are abstract and dreamy, and, you know, just need someone to take care of them while they do their big thinking.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying. Now it's very common. But in the 30s, I would not think that that was the go-to gender division.
I don't know. What about Dorothea Brooke and Casaubon?
Yeah, I don't think that that works the same way at all. Because, yeah, maybe she wants to support him as a great man. But she also has all of her own projects and plans. And that's really what she would prefer to do.
Yeah, they're totally put on the back burner during her marriage, though.
Yeah, but it doesn't last
very
long.
She tries very hard to sacrifice all those things.
Sure. Well, we could talk forever about Middlemarch. I'm just saying, it rings more true with today's gender discourse, where women are forced to do emotional labor and deal with these man-child types, right?
Yeah, I think...
who don't want to get a real bed.
I think it's a recurring trope, and maybe that's one version of it.
So Garson Kanin, I think, is anticipating, in a way. But there is a cost to that, right? And as you say, Virginia Weidler is... she's forced to do all of the thinking for the family. Now, the brother is great, too, Peter Holden. But he's playing just another dreamy little guy, right?
Yeah.
But he does that really well, too. Both kids are great, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, she is forced to run the family.
Right, and that actually entails serving them. Although I was shocked when he very badly ironed his own pants.
Yeah, well, as you can... so this is, again, the man-child trope. Like, they're so bad at doing it that the woman has to just do it.
Sure.
Right? So that's how they get away with forcing the role onto the woman. Again, it's all here in 1939. We get a lot of talk about... like, the kids know he's an alcoholic. It's no secret. And she forces him to drink castor oil, which presumably is going to cause him to at least eject some of the alcohol poisoning.
Have you ever had castor oil?
Well, no.
I have. It's disgusting.
Of course. It has to be
it's
to achieve
oil.
The effect.
Ugh.
That's the whole point of it.
Taking off from the oil and gauze on a baby's stomach from,
yeah.
from Bachelor Mother.
Maybe. He drinks it down. He says he's going to do it. So she is the major domo. He's still the intellectual figurehead, giving them information about the past, mostly, not really about how to live today. He lets them deal with that themselves. He tells anyone that asks that those kids can take care of themselves. They're always here in the morning when I get home. So they're latchkey kids, basically. In the classroom, I mean, they make an immediate impact on the new teacher, Miss Billow. She's dealing with brats. Davy McCarty.
Well, she's already identified the Harvard cry.
Exactly.
That we hear a few times in the movie.
That's right. In moments of stress, your children give voice to the old Harvard cry, Reinhardt.
So she's more sophisticated than most of the teachers.
She's from Boston.
Yeah.
And this is not Boston. That's the only thing we know.
So she values the intellectual life, and she knows who John Barrymore is later.
She's read all of his books, and she's his most devoted fan. She's always dreamed of meeting him.
Again, not so great on gender.
No, it's true.
But this is the story. How are we going to get the great man back on his feet? Even the title is very Preston Sturges.
It is, of course. And it's all very Sturgeon. Bachelor Mother has a lot of Sturges aspects. This has even more, right? The way a stupid, badly organized society that's just a complete chaos that benefits no one on purpose will somehow raise someone up just by accident for no rhyme or reason.
Yeah, it's true. It doesn't like move the way a Sturges screenplay does, but those elements are there.
It's the same end result.
Yeah.
Yeah. With, I mean, I won't say more pathos because Sturges has more pathos than people give him credit for quite often.
Well, he's a lot of pathos.
Yeah.
Not in like the Lady Eve, but in his Eddie Bracken movies.
Yeah, definitely. Hail the Conquering
and,
Hero.
And Christmas in July too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Of course. So the Sturgeon elements are the fact that there's an election coming along, and we're introduced very early on to Iron Hat McCarty, the ward healer. He's the precinct boss, and there's a little playground rhyme that the kids sing. Iron Hat McCarty, the pride of his party. So he gives out candies because they're all little voters one day, right? This is how the Democratic Party kept its stranglehold on northern cities throughout the early 20th century.
By giving out candy to children?
Yeah, and giving out little perks wherever it could. Again, they stood for no particular policy, but they controlled patronage and they used it wherever they could to get benefits into the hands of working class people, right? So even though they were not anything like a socialist or social democratic party until the New Deal, they were already taking care of distributing spoils downward wherever they could, right? So
what does it indicate that Barrymore doesn't want to vote for them?
No, he does always vote the straight ticket. And in fact, there's...
What? Okay, no, but explain this language. What the hell is the straight ticket?
Okay, well, American listeners will know that because it's still a thing in the United States.
Okay.
Elections are ridiculously comprehensive in the United States, more than anywhere else in the world. In Canada, on election day, at certain times, we will vote on a few things, right?
Yeah, there's...
School board.
Yeah, a list of half a dozen things sometimes, of which I care nothing for most of them because I have no children.
But an American ballot often would go all the way down from president to dog catcher, right? That's the classic.
Yeah, but what does it mean to say... But if you say, I'll vote the straight ticket, it always means you're voting for the Democratic Party?
In a city, pretty much, yes. But it could be, in another context, it could be voting the straight ticket for the Republican Party, right? And they don't say it's the Democratic Party. But in an urban environment in the North, really, the Republicans were not going to win, for the most part. Not in the 20s. So it's pretty clear. And because they're talking about Irish ward healers like McCarthy, it's obviously the Democratic Party, right?
Right.
And that's all it means. The straight ticket, you just go down and vote for every single candidate run by the Democratic Party for every office you can imagine. Judges, prosecutors, dog catcher.
But do we think that Barrymore has some kind of values-based objection to machine politics?
Most people would have, right? It doesn't live up to the ideals of democracy, which are that people are making free, rational choices about who is going to run the country for the benefit of all the people.
It is very unsturgeon to have an intellectual as your main character.
That's true. Well, except for Sullivan's Travels.
Well, yeah. That's a Hollywood director trying to be an intellectual. So sort of like Sturges himself, Sturges coming from an intellectual background, trying to be a Hollywood director.
Right. Yeah.
Oh yeah. And Unfaithful Yours too.
Yeah, exactly. I think that it
can happen.
It's not alien to Sturges,
no.
But it's true. You get usually a more Joe Public kind of person that's raised up or thrown down.
Yeah. Well,
by the whims
I'm just,
of fate.
Yeah. I'm just thinking about those types of movies of his.
So that's the background here. The election is coming up, and we go into the smoky room and we see the party officials and the way they think, which is just total superstition craziness, right? Now, William Demarest is the delegate who comes to speak to them. He's presumably a representative of the statewide party, I guess. And he says, you know, you've heard of Maine. As Maine goes, so goes the nation. And this is the kind of thing that you still get in crazy prognostication on how votes are going to go, right? What's the number one predictor of elections? They'll look at a state, they'll look at a precinct, they'll look at a ward and try to extrapolate from that. And they've determined, their statistical scientists have determined that the 13th precinct of the first ward, I think it is the number one indicator of how things are going to go across the board. Now, they know they're going to win the city. That's a foregone conclusion. But obviously there must be other stakes here, like who's going to be the governor, maybe. And maybe even it's a presidential election. Who knows? They don't really say. Demarest says that if they can get unanimous votes out of this 13th precinct, it's going to bode well for the party in larger arenas as well. Ironhat McCarthy, you know, we've seen him lording it over people in his precinct. And again, it's kind of like the way Frank Albertson and some of these other big talking people, you know, in their small ponds, as soon as they get into a larger pond, they're exposed as very weak and vulnerable.
It almost reminded me of just like a flash, thinking of that, watching the movie, of the communist in Pick Up on South Street, who seems like such a terrifying gangster, and then we find out that he's working for bosses that completely control everything he does and can threaten his own life.
McCarthy is talked down to, treated like an idiot by the party leaders, and threatened that But if he does not deliver the 13th precinct, he's done. He will no longer be working for the Democratic Party, and good luck finding a job doing anything else with his skill set, which doesn't seem to be anything.
Meanwhile, the children have gotten into an altercation with his son.
His horrible son.
His horrible son that even he doesn't like.
No, nobody likes him.
But obviously the fact that he does do this petty small pond lording over has affected the way that his son behaves. Yeah, so they get into quite the physical fight. Virginia Weidler gets a shiner.
Yeah, she gets punched in the face.
Takes it pretty well, though.
Donald Ainsley Vads charges, yelling Reinhardt, and knocks this asshole into the cement.
Yeah.
A great little joke when the construction workers find out that he's Iron Hat McCarty's son. They do get him out of there, but then they look down at the impression of an ass and they say, spitting image of his old man.
And then this precipitates, on the one hand, the children running off to find their mother's wealthy parents.
Yeah, and this is, again, wonderful social criticism, because they're like, okay, the powers that be are going to come after us now, and they're going to take us away from our dad. We know he can't fight back. He is a drunk working at a factory. The only chance we have is to enlist these in-laws or, you know, relatives who we never see because they close the iron door on their drunk father. They own a dairy business, and presumably these kids have never even seen them, or not since they were born.
But they seem to be ready to welcome the children back.
Well, again, they're like Charles Coburn. They want a relationship with their grandchildren, right? It's never even really talked about exactly what happened between them all, but you have to imagine they disapproved of their daughter marrying this wild-eyed intellectual, and then she died, and he got even worse and drunk, and they just have not, they don't even know where he is and where their grandchildren are.
Yeah, I guess maybe.
It's a very dramatic backstory that's underplayed, right? And they don't even know how to find them. The only way they can figure out to do it is to stow away on a milk truck, a real milk truck, rather than a bootlegger's milk truck, and go out to the country and just ask people, hey, how do we find the Ainsleys? And the country is presented as this idyllic space, and they have a little conversation.
Well, yeah, if you're rich in the country, which you often are in the studio era Hollywood movies.
Yeah. Well, and again, it's idyllic for a specific reason, which Virginia Weidler points out. It's not that people are any less mean in the country, it's that there are just fewer of them pushing you around.
Right.
So that's nice. You've got a little more living space. And
don't fence me in.
Yeah. They get hungry. It's always been one of my favorite moments where they decide to go after some apples and she's like, well, I don't know if we should start stealing just yet.
Well, but they do sort of own the apples. That's what, you know, they can go on.
We see like just an unbelievably gross speech by the grandmother, right? Talking to her gardener who says, you know, I don't mind keeping you on because I know you've got a bunch of family members to support, but I don't want you taking advantage of my charity, you lazy lout. I'll just get rid of you and bring on someone younger who can do the job. Just a horrible woman. And again, this is, you know, what passes for a social benefactor.
Right. Yet they turn to sweetness and honey as soon as they start to figure out who these children are.
Again, yeah, because it's blood and lineage. Then they're different, obviously. With anyone that they perceive as just under their thumb in their power, they're horrifying. So, the grandfather gets a notion that this may be, it's possible, this is their long-lost granddaughter because she looks like the mother.
She doesn't.
Not really. The mother, the painting of the mother, or the photo, the faded photo, looks like Ingrid Bergman.
But maybe there's something about her that's reminiscent in her manner.
She's apparently exactly the same. Joan the First and Joan the Second is what Barrymore keeps saying. They chow down and trying to keep cagey about who their dad is, but they say that they're in trouble. They give all the backstory without naming any names. It all comes out when they're presented with the image of their mother, and Virginia Weidler blurts out, Mom! And the grandparents are overjoyed that they've found them, and they know what to do. It's basically like Charles Coburn. They're going to get their lawyers together and take the kids away.
He is a very unfit parent.
It's really taking chances here, because...
Although at the same time, the children seem to be doing extremely well, except that they're sad for their father. That's really the problem. And this is what fascinated me about Barrymore's performance in this role. He's obviously sad that he lost his wife. Devastated, right?
Well, that's why he drinks. Yeah. All day long.
Yes. But other than that, He doesn't seem angry, bitter, or unhappy. He seems to enjoy spending time with his children, educating them. He doesn't seem himself to possess ambition.
Well, no, that's what he says. He's only showing off.
So that's what's kind of interesting about it. Like, he doesn't seem like... The problem with alcoholism is not that it makes him angry or in itself makes him sad. It's nevertheless that he's killing himself, like, yeah, in front of his children.
Yeah.
And they realize that.
They're unfortunate lot to be aware enough to see that their dad, even though they love him, is not going to be with them for very long if he keeps living this way. It casts a shadow over their happy little home. I like their place.
But because he is so genial and cheerful, right? It does seem like a happy home, even though it's established that they're very poor and he's drunk all the time and he has no idea where they are.
That's right. So yeah, if anything does start to go wrong, as it does here, they run off to the country because they're afraid of repercussions of a fight at school. Like, he does not react well. He doesn't know what to do. He just sits there and waits for them to come home. Miss Billow shows up, and that's where it all comes out. And she makes the astonished discovery that this is Gregory Vance. Well, what are you doing here?
The other thing that's been precipitated, of course, is that he loses his job.
It's all a consequence of this fight between the children. And again, we're told that it's not Donald McBride, Iron Hat McCarty, that wants to do this. It's the mother. That's like, this is an insult to our family. You must have this guy fired. But we see, whatever the reason is, when he goes to the factory owner and says, you must discharge Gregory Vance, the guy doesn't want to do it. And Iron Hat says, well, you are blocking traffic. It's taking me a lot to keep those inspectors off your back. You sure you want to defy me on this? And he's like, well, no, okay, I'll fire him. Barrymore understands this, does not take it out on his boss. He just is like, well, that's how this world works. It's just the most corrupt possible thing you can imagine, right? It's all controlled by patronage and whims, and goes out to drink with the bootlegger. And they're having a discussion where he's being pretty insulting to El Bernie. Your people were hill people. Not given to expressing themselves verbally or something like that.
The Macedonian, we're told.
Well, he calls him a bunch of different things. He does call him a Macedonian at one point, but Louis Alberni is also in some Sturges movies. He's in, well, not Sturges directed, but he's got a great role in Easy Living as Louis, the owner of the Hotel Louis. In Wizzibles, they get a phone call. He's been summoned back home by the party machine and the kids. Donald McBride must make all kinds of escalating offers, and the kids are the ones doing the negotiation. Again, it's all Virginia Weidler. She is like, don't take janitor, Dad. Obviously, they need you for something, so you better keep upping the ante. And McCarty has no choice but to go all the way up to Commissioner of Education before she finally orders him to accept.
Yes, and this is where we get, not a teacher. Teaching is for ladies. So we understand how the hierarchies work here.
Absolutely, yeah. We're told that the Commissioner of Schools is actually, at the moment, the mayor's brother-in-law. So that's the kind of world we're living in here. And they're going to have to displace the mayor's brother-in-law, find some other sinecure for him so that Gregory Vance can do his thing and maybe get a little bit more in-depth learning about ancient Rome into the schools.
Yeah, he was very happy to accept janitor.
Totally. He has no ambition. Nope. We're told repeatedly. And only Joan II can help him out of this.
Well, it's partly because they don't want to be taken away, and they would like to live a little better, these children.
Whenever he says, you know, you've never been hungry. Well, practically, never. Yeah.
And they all have, like, one set of clothing or something?
Yeah, he's only got one pair of pants. That we know for sure. All of this comes to pass, and then the Ainsley lawyers descend upon them. We know that, or we think, anyway, that he now has this trump card to play against them, because they're counting on the fact that he is one of life's losers and cannot fight back against the Ainsley money and the Ainsley legal team. And when he says that he is now commissioner of schools, well, they don't believe him. It's like Ginger Rogers. They won't believe anything he says, and they've got a psychiatrist on hand. They've got everyone on hand.
Well, that's a very funny moment when
they're
going to
test his reflexes.
Barrymore threatens to kick his glasses
off.
Don't
be surprised if I kick your glasses off.
He looks absolutely wild.
Yeah, he does.
It's another return to 20th century moment.
And then we get the very deflating statement at the end. Everyone else is gone, just the main lawyer is there, and he says, oh, I guess you're not crazy. You've just been talking to Iron Hat McCarty and believing him. That cheap ward healer couldn't deliver anything, right? And that's where Barrymore says, well, I was afraid of that. So sorry, kids. I didn't want to burst your bubble, but it seemed like those were empty promises.
Luckily, Joan II is like Lucy in the Charlie Brown.
She's very much like Lucy.
Cartoons, yeah. And she understands how contracts work.
Yeah, this is a real thing. And the party is that superstitious that they're willing to make these sacrifices on the patronage level just to get a news story. Vote with Vance. They're enlisting his intellectual support as a major thinker of our time.
And suddenly he's Jordan Peterson.
And he is celebrated author. It's just that nobody realized what had become of him, that he's the same guy that's working as a night watchman. And when they put it all together, it makes sense that it's feasible in this kind of fairy tale that that's how it would all play out.
But Dave, I think you and I know, as well as anyone on this planet knows, that you certainly can have highly educated intellectuals that just don't really give a shit about doing anything.
No, that's right. That's us.
Today he'd have a podcast.
No, of course. He'd be talking about the Picts and the Scots on there. And I'd listen, I'm sure. The big day comes. Like the end of Bachelor Mother, actually, they're planning to run away, right? They stow away on a delivery truck. They're found by the tough guy that drives it. And he's actually in Bachelor Mother, too, at the Pink Slipper, who said, oh, you can dance with one of our hostesses. I like that actor. He's in The Maltese Falcon, too. I have no idea who he is. Oh, and he's in Saboteur. He's the truck driver in Saboteur. He's a celebrity, right? So they're trying to get out of town because they know they can't fight the Ainsleys now that they don't think they have this job. And no, it turns out in newspaper stories, it's all happening. He has been elevated to a stature where he can defend his interests again.
Right.
He can keep his family together, all based on this whim of William Demarest's, really. The parade plays out and Vance gets to insist upon wearing Iron Hat McCarty's clothes and he parades to the polls. We get to see a ceremony that is not very different today, right? There's someone sitting there, you say your name, they check to see if you're on the rolls, they give you a piece of paper, you go into a secret place, he stamps a lot of tickets. Maybe he voted the straight ticket except for the mayor or something, who knows what he did. And then he brings it back, nobody can see who he voted for, they rip off a tab and they put it in the box. That's exactly what they do now.
Right.
So voting technology has not changed. Although in the US they've got a lot of those computer voting systems, which doesn't seem to be working out so well for them. Paper ballot. That's the way to go. We've got an election coming up very soon in Ontario, at least.
So exciting.
Doug Ford, will he remain? Hopefully not. But the other options aren't so great either, really. So nothing's changed there either from 1923 in this fictional town. During the ceremony, we do get the mayor, Granville Bates.
I wish I was a key voter, I can tell you that much. I would absolutely take like a top job that I'm qualified for if someone just walked in and offered it to me.
Yeah.
Please, anytime.
Granville Bates is the mayor. He must have had some kind of friendship with Garson Kanin. He's in a bunch of Kanin's movies. He's amazing in this movie. He's great in My Favorite Wife as well. He's the judge in that extended crazy sequence, which we'll be doing for Valentine's Day next year, I think, right? Mm-hmm. Anyway, here he gets up to speak because he's not really paying attention during the smoky room meeting, and they're like, sit down, it's not your turn yet. And then when he does finally speak, nobody pays attention, right? Here, we find out that, you know, he actually is sort of aware of what's going on, and he's not too keen on this promise that's been made, because now he's gonna have to find something for his brother-in-law to do, but he finally admits that he'll have to do it, and they get it in writing, so it's a done deal. The kids, again, insist on that, as you said, get it in writing.
Yeah, with a witness.
Yep, McCarty has to sign it. And, of course, the punchline is that he secretly voted against the mayor, and maybe against the whole party. Probably he did, right? The reason that's not self-defeating is because he knows they're gonna win anyway, so he will get the job, but he gets the moral satisfaction of having not voted for them.
Right.
And he makes Miss Billow the principal, and they become a family, and they walk happily arm in arm into the new world.
Yeah, a corrupt family full of patronage.
Yeah, it's great.
Well, that's what you gotta do.
There is no way to be morally pure under capitalism.
It's all you can do.
You just take what comes.
And, you know, try to find moral loopholes if you can.
Exactly. That's Garson Kanin's point of view, and I think that's Preston Sturges' point of view. I think we're seeing some patterns here amongst the heartwarming satirists of the era. So did you love it?
I'm not sure if I love it as much as you do. I like it. Yeah, I think obviously Barrymore's great in it, and it gives him more to do. I mean, all of his little character comedy roles are great, as well as his full-on 1934 comedy role in 20th Century, but this gives him more to do than most of his roles after the early 30s, for sure.
Yeah, because it's got more to it, but it's got some amazingly wild dialogue and physical comedy. I refuse to have traffic with such a fickle changeling.
Yeah, I mean, it's perfect for him to play this dreamer and this mercurial intellectual who, as I said, is so sad and yet so cheerful and gentle at the same time.
Unique character and uniquely fitted to John Barrymore, and we're just really lucky that it came along right at the perfect moment for him to embody it.
And he, at the cost of his literal life.
Unfortunately, yeah.
And you see him in all of his dealings with McCarthy and with the officials that are going to take his children away. You see that despite this completely impractical quality, and despite the deterioration, his physical and mental deterioration, and his sort of health, his economic helplessness, despite all of these things, that he is ultimately very canny and aware of all of these machinations, obviously in a way that the children aren't. So there is a sense in which he is practical, that he has this worldly knowledge.
Scholars know things, and they observe things about human societies. His speech is interesting, too, at the end.
Yeah, what is this end speech? Like, obviously it's carrying the themes of the movie. Given this satire that we've been talking about, what do you think this speech about the power of voting and the gentle strength of America is?
That's the diehard progressive side of Garson Kanin, right? It's akin to the scenes where we see all of the kids of different races in the same classroom being all treated as American citizens. That's the idea, that's the dream of America. That's certainly what the country claims to be, right? It's a place where, as Barrymore says, even the least citizen is great in a country where strength is so magnanimous or so generous or whatever.
But right? It's not, it's clearly, not. And it's not depicted that way in the movie.
No, and he knows that. But what he's saying is, if we just live up to our ideals, well, maybe we'd have something here, right? And I think that's what Garson Kanin is saying. Now, again, without socialist revolution, I'm not sure that that really gets you anywhere. But the ideals of democracy, you know, they do ultimately, they need to lead to socialism.
Right.
And Barrymore doesn't say that, but I will say it for him. If those little wedges that having universal voting system open up lead to people voting for socialism, well, then you'd really have something. And certainly Marx thought that would happen, but not yet.
Had some problems, that theory.
And the movie makes no bones about what the problems are. It's that there is no one right now to vote for that's going to do anything to actually bring this to fruition. But I guess there's always a chance that there will be at some point if people insist on it strongly enough. I don't know. Can they? Do they have the power to call into being a candidate that will actually do something? Not yet, but maybe someday. All right. Well, I think that's it for this week, isn't it?
It is. So, Dave, you're busy on the Discord. You're doing things on it. You're putting things on it for people to look at and comment on if they so desire. And we even have a few people in it.
We do. And we'll see how it goes. Again, it's very early on. I know that, you know, a critical mass is the way to go in order to get discussions going.
What have we been saying, Dave? It's like that I'm on a couple of Discords and servers, and I have one of my own. They are kind of like parties. The one that I have is very small. I think it has maybe 15 people on it. But that's like a good... If these people are already, you know, kind of know each other, as we do, from other areas on the internet, that's a good recipe for a party. But right now, you know, and even so, it's not like a raucous party. It just comes and goes. It ebbs and flows. It has its waves. And then it silences. But right now, our Discord is kind of like the party where it's like... A few people showed up at 7 o'clock, and the hosts are saying, oh, no, it's going to pick up at like 11, at 11. And everyone's standing in the corner with a beer, not talking to each other.
Yeah.
And they need a few more beers as well as a few more people.
Yeah. So we'll see where it goes. And again, there's no commitment. If you join it, you don't have to participate. You know, you could just see what's there. You could lurk.
By law, you have to participate if you join.
But I am going to make a practice of putting more stuff into it from now on. I've got got it divided up in a way that I think makes intuitive sense, so you can find the episodes that you want to comment on or talk about older episodes that predate the Discord's arrival.
Yeah, we just, like, absolutely don't use our Facebook page, basically.
No, I haven't used it in a while.
And so if I find some things like an article or something in the course of research, I'll put it on the Discord.
And because Malton and Forgotten Films to Remember are so important to my early development as a film fan, and it's quite relevant, especially to the Hollywood Studios Year by Year series, I am going to start putting all of that material into the Discord for each film, if you're interested in that stuff. It's more self-indulgent on my part than anything else,
so
I suppose.
So is this whole podcast?
That's true, exactly.
On our parts?
And I've got some polls on there now, too, which you can vote on. They're not time sensitive. You can vote on them anytime. I'm interested to see what people's favorite studios are. And also, I've asked people if they want to vote on who their favorite actor is so far out of our five. So check it out. To join it...
Yeah, don't just let Daniel Day-Lewis win.
To join it, just send us a message any way that you would like to. You can message us on Twitter. You can message us through Instagram. You can message us by sending a Gmail to theirbuggy@gmail.com, and we'll send you an invite code to the Discord.
Oh yeah, and if you've never used Discord before, I'm really old, 46.
And not very tech savvy at all.
Well, we're reasonably tech savvy, but yeah, it took me like one day to figure out how to use it, and yeah, you within a day figured out how to make one. We both made one by now, so it's really easy.
Next week on the podcast, it'll be Gangs of New York, and there will be blood.
Whoa!
Daniel Day-Lewis Part 7. So this is our penultimate episode of Daniel Day-Lewis.
Those are long fucking movies.
So next Sunday, Elise, we will be watching movies for most of the day and then talking for the rest of it. It's gonna be non-stop yelling and craziness on the screen.
From Daniel, anyway.
So looking forward to that.
Mm-hmm.